Approval of minutes from September 28th, do we have a motion?
Move approval.
Is there a second?
Second.
Edits, revisions, comments? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed, minutes are carried. Under the appearance section, we have Ann Wellman, 4529 Winnica Road, would like to speak regarding the Schluter Beach Playground budget. Ann, welcome.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone.
Aye.
So, we're all Monona citizens. We all know what's happening at Schluter Beach if we're paying attention. So, I did send a letter. I hope everyone did read the letter so they see where I'm coming from regarding that the beach was slated not to have any equipment for the next year, playground equipment specifically, and that it was not in the budget, and that they were going to do a study to see how the park was used without the equipment. Graciously, our mayor has, Mayor Miller, made an incentive to locate $20,000 within the park budget of the Schluter Beach budget. So after an hour, they found where to find $20,000 for playground equipment. I had requested $50,000. Mm-hmm. And I spoke with Administrator Anderson today just to kind of get a recap of what has been happening with the other playgrounds in Monona, neighborhood playgrounds. So Oneida, which was done in 2007, $40,000 was allotted for playground equipment. The Blue Park, $40,000 was allotted for playground equipment. Arrowhead was allotted $50,000, and Jake informed me that their total expenditure was $80,000. So I feel that the $20,000 is very grateful, considering there was nothing on the plate before. But if you're looking at a park where you figure 80% of the usage is children, let's be realistic. Let's take our heads out of the clouds and realize that's what's at the park. And at $20,000, that's just a little over 3% of the total $579,000 that's being used at that park. So the $50,000 was just about 10%, which within the ballpark of these other three parks that were done. $50,000, I do not feel, is an outrageous amount, specifically also that it is serving everyone north of West Dean Avenue. It's roughly over 1,000 residents living north. I can give you the breakdown also of student population there. It's roughly 13% of the elementary school that lives north of West Dean Avenue. The closest park for them to participate in, if there is this $20,000 put there, the next one. Oh, and also, I'm not sure if this is handicap accessible. I think that the city needs to really look and see if this playground equipment that's going in matching ADA. And I did request that that be an issue that looked into. I think that the looking at what has been done, as I said, at other parks, the city should maybe investigate how this could be a gateway park, in a sense, into Monona. You're coming right off Monona Drive. It's the first full-fledged neighborhood park you approach coming off of Monona Drive. So, I understand their scope of looking at the water. It's wonderful real estate sales. But I think if you talk to the people who live in that neighborhood, they move there because of the park, the ice cream store, the open space that's there at Waterman Way. It was more than just the scope of the view. So thank you, everyone. I hope that the letter is read and taken to heart. Good evening.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who wishes to speak on an item that's not on the agenda? Seeing none, we'll close the appearance section. If there's no unfinished business, we'll go to new business. 6A, consideration of action on proposal for approval of a landscape ground sign permit and flagpole permits with special exception requirements claimed to be installed at the entrance of the WPS campus at 1717 West Broadway. And Mr. Humbert?
I'm currently working for WPS, so I'll have to abstain.
Thank you. Very good. Did you want to...
Who's going to handle my pictures?
Good evening. My name is Mary Beth Brownie from Ryan Signs, and we appreciate the opportunity to be with you tonight. As you could see through our submittal, WPS is looking to remove four of their building signs and replace one of them. The sign that would be replaced is on the Corporate Center building, which on your site plan is 1751 West Broadway. We will be removing the WPS bank sign, which is currently covered. The WPS message has been concealed for several months. And we will be removing anywhere from 2 to 3 flagpoles in front of each of the 4 buildings on the campus. Our new signage is going to include the rebranding of WPS, and again, through the submittals that we have, the new messaging is going to be WPS Health Solutions. The last time that WPS changed their brand was approximately 30 years ago, so we're all pretty excited at the new image in our community. As I mentioned, one of the wall signs will be replaced on the 1751 building. And then we are also requesting a new monument sign on Broadway. This is a sign that has never been in existence. We will actually be refacing the 2 signs that face the Beltline, one east and one west. And those signs are not changing in dimension at all, just the graphics themselves. And then we will be adding to this entry feature 3 new flagpoles, 2 of them at 25 feet. That'll be the state of Wisconsin, the WPS flags. And then the American flag will be flown at 30 feet with your approval. For your consideration, we are really looking for you to consider WPS's presence on Monona Drive, or in Monona and on Broadway. The signage and flagpoles fit with the scale of the campus. We have approximately 1,500 feet of frontage on Broadway. And feel very strongly that a smaller sign and the shorter flagpole would be out of scale with the size of the campus on Broadway. And just sort of as a comment, the American flag always has to fly higher than other flags. And so if the flagpoles are all at 25 feet or 25, it'd be 25 and 20. The other 2 flags always look like they're at half staff or less than full staff if the flagpoles are the same size. And then I think in a couple buildings they are at the same size right now. So just a really nice balance to have that American flag a little bit higher. And again, looking at this as an entry feature to the campus, and we hope that you will look kindly on our request and our considerations.
Thank you. Stay there, Sonia. Do you want to
Sure. So really there are 2 signs on the agenda that require plan commission approval. One is the landscape ground sign, and with that, as proposed, it requires an exception of 3 feet in height and 15 square feet in size over what is normally allowed. And the second item that needs to be approved by the plan commission is the flagpole exception, which adds 5 feet over what would normally be allowed to have it at 30 feet versus 25. So the other sign changes that are proposed don't directly require a plan commission permit, but are useful to understand for the amount of signage on the campus overall. And the staff recommendation is that some variance may be appropriate based on the size and scale of the campus, and if the plan commission determines that an exception may be granted, then the findings of fact and conditions for that are listed in the staff report.
Thank you. Commission members, comments? Mr. Ganser.
I think the new branding looks great. I think it's nice. I also like the name, the Health Solutions is sounds great. I think the it's certainly refreshing the two signs on the Beltline. That's a good idea, and that we don't have to approve them. I think they look great, and certainly would be in favor of them. I have no issues with the raised flag pole, 5 feet for the U.S. flag. 25 feet is actually a rather modest height for a flag pole. I do question the size of the sign on Broadway. However, I do understand the argument that, you know, it's a huge campus, and of course having WPS in the neighborhood is obviously a big deal, and we appreciate that they're here. I don't look at I understand that argument, but I really don't look at it. I'm looking at the sign in and of itself, and its feel in terms of vehicle and pedestrian traffic. And it seems that the city has been very, very strict about that 5 foot height and that square footage. And for example, to talk about the argument, the size of the campus, I'd be in favor of two signs that fit within the Monona ordinance height and size. I'd be more in agreement giving you 120 square feet. I'd be more in favor of that than 75 square feet in one sign and the 8 foot height. It may be in scale with the campus, but I'm not so sure it's in scale with Broadway and the speed limit. So I'm a little uncomfortable with that.
Thank you. We had a Alderman Quist sent in something. Do you want to put that into record, please?
So, Alder Holmquist, who's absent tonight, said he likes the overall reduction of signs on the campus. The new sign looks good and seems to pull the entire campus together to the main entrance. He agrees with the report that the size and scale of the sign is appropriate to the frontage. There have been discussions about increasing the height of signs to allow a base to elevate the sign above landscaping. And he questions, is the base of 2 feet needed? Could this be reduced to 1 foot? And are there site issues with being pushed that far forward in the median?
Other commission members, any comments? Mr. Kugel.
Well, I like the idea of the signs coming off the buildings and all the flagpoles coming down. And I think that the larger sign in the front for the size of your campus, I don't have an issue with it. I think a small sign out in front of there for a campus that large would look out of place. My only concern would be is it set back far enough that you don't have issues with the cars that are pulling out and in? And I would think that's something the city engineer could look at before it's put up. But I don't have a problem with the size of the sign, just so it doesn't obstruct traffic.
Thank you. Rob?
I like the sign a lot. I think the scale of it is appropriate, especially on that main spine of the campus. It's kind of an access, and I think it lends itself to be larger just due to the scale of the property. I did drive over there, and I think that is a signalized intersection, so you know, visibility I don't think would be an issue because of that.
Mm-hmm.
If it was an unsignalized intersection, then maybe pushing it back I think would be warranted. But I think it'd be sign. I think it's a really attractive sign, and I have no problem with the size of it, and I think it's actually appropriate in this case.
Mr. Dorsal?
I don't have any problem with the flagpoles. I do have a little concern about the size of the sign, but given the size of the campus, and the fact that this actually might help to unify and bring all of this complex together, I guess that I would accept it based on the size of the campus. I have a little concern, too, about lines of visibility. And I guess I'd like to have some reassurance from city engineer or company that it doesn't interfere with any space or traffic.
Mr. Chairman,
you bet.
If I may, We have walked the site and we don't see any issues with the visibility, but we would be more than happy to meet city engineering on site to show the front of the sign in relationship to the crosswalk, as well as that, you know, thicker line where people are supposed to stop behind a...
Well, a little bit sensitive because there's a new sign that has gone up that blocks visibility when you pull up to it. So there's a little sensitivity by the commission on that issue. That'd be appreciated. Is there a motion?
I'll move approval on the sign, incorporating the findings of fact and conditions of approval recommended by staff, and adding a third condition that the position of the sign be reviewed by the city engineer to ensure that there are no visibility line problems.
Is there a second?
Can I ask a question before?
Yes, please.
On your night graphic, there shows uplighting on the flagpoles. Is there any, and this is kind of a question, discussion, I guess, is there any sort of regulations on lighting? Is that going to be an issue at all with the uplighting on the flagpole, just since I've noticed it? Is that part of the plan?
It is.
Okay.
Yes.
I looked at this, and I don't believe there are any regulations in the sign code specifically that would prohibit uplighting. But in the lighting section of the zoning code, it says that if it becomes disturbing to neighboring properties or spills over, that it needs to be regulated.
And if I may, we are removing one of the light poles in the median where the light poles are going. Hopefully the light output will be pretty much the same.
Mr. Kogel?
Just one thing under findings of fact number one, is after the last sentence, where it's one long sentence, says the sign code standards would be out of scale in relation to the campus. Is it would not be out of scale?
I'm actually wording it there with if the sign were required to meet the regulations of 60 square foot and 5 foot in height, that would be out of scale. Okay.
Understood.
Okay, did we have a second?
I'd second.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed?
Thank you.
Thank you. We are moving to 6B, consideration of action on request for approval of a landscape ground sign permit and removal of the existing pylon sign at McDonald's and then at Dodge and Drive. Steven. Your name and...
Yep, Chad Schultz with Innovative Signs.
Thanks, Chad. Do you want to give us a...
Yeah, it's pretty easy, I guess. They'd like to remove the existing pylon sign that's there with the big M, and they're going to replace it with a smaller monument sign that's approximately 20 square feet. The new sign portion of that itself is about 10 square feet, so it's much smaller. They're going to place it about 15 feet off of the lot line, which is the sidewalk, so it's close to where the existing pylon sign is.
Sonia?
So in 2013, the McDonald's site was reconstructed, and as a condition of their zoning permit, the Plan Commission required that the non-conforming pylon sign be removed, and that deadline to remove the sign was in August. So this request is for approval of the new ground sign to replace it once it comes down. And the sign, as proposed, meets the standards, except for that a landscaping plan was not provided in the submittal. So in the recommendation, I have that the sign can be approved with final submittal of that landscaping plan to staff.
Thank you, Mr. Ganser.
I want a business that I don't even have to put the name on.
I'm kidding.
What it is. I want that kind of business.
Yeah. Good marketing.
It's fine. It's wonderful.
Other commission member comments?
Who can follow that?
Trying to say anything, Mr. Amber?
No, I think it looks fine.
Okay.
I guess I do want to say something.
Yeah.
Sorry. Since we don't have dimensioning on it, I know it'll be far enough back, but I think another condition should be on there that it meets our setback requirements off the curb line. I know you're putting back further, but we don't have anything of record on file. So I'd move approval with the two conditions, then add a third condition that it's a minimum of 15 foot off the curb line.
Okay. Second?
Second.
Further discussion?
Yes.
Yes.
I just put it in there so that we have it of record. I know you're putting it even further back. But.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
Okay. Further discussion, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Will that be the last pylon sign in the home?
No.
What's left?
Ken's. I think there are three of them.
Angelo's.
And
does Angelo have a Pepsi?
They have a roof sign.
Oh, they have a roof sign. Sorry. Okay.
Does the bowling alley have one still?
No, but the business next to Taco John's that says Madison Area Bowling or ABC Builders, I think they have one.
And Monongro Businessmen Association.
Yes.
We'll move on to 6C, which is review approval of design options for replacement community ground sign message area corner of Nova Drive, Broadway, and
the sign is in front of the PDQ, and the electronic message center that used to be there has been removed. It's been removed for months, and that was required to be removed by the Wisconsin DOT because they have standards that require or that prohibit electronic changeable messages in their right of way. So now we have a hole that needs to be filled, and we've contacted the same company that did the gateway feature further south off of the Beltline on Monona Drive, and they've provided three options for your feedback. And see, I had some questions. Do we want it to say Monona or welcome to Monona, or are there elements of this that would be overdone since we have waves in Monona further south already? Just your general feedback so that I can give the sign company your recommendation.
Okay. And we've got a comment from
Brian. Says he understands the issue with the sign, although I wonder if we are overdoing the welcome to Monona signs with having the two off the belt line. If we have to go with something there, I like the third option with the waves.
Mm-hmm. I have a question. Is it true that if this were just a couple feet back, we could put in the changeable board if it's out of the right of way?
I think that's correct.
If and we can't move it back because?
I'd be happy to contact PDQ. I do a lot of work for them, and I don't think they have a problem issuing us a easement to put the sign back a little bit if we wanted to.
Are there utility boxes behind
sure.
it?
Sure. There's a tank fence. There's all kinds of stuff. It'd be worth exploring.
Okay.
Be aware of the relationship to the two street signs, though, because as mm-hmm. that goes back, they're going to come like this, and then the sign's going to be set back from those two points.
Unless you move them.
Unless they go too, sure.
I just, something for discussion. Mr. Amber.
A, I think that's a great idea. That should be thoroughly investigated before we make a commitment. B, if we did this sign, I think we're really dropping the ball. We've done so well on Monona Drive. We did so much. Tell me where we did a sign on what street where we had a metal infill instead of stone. This
Thank
thing
you.
Should have stone infill where all that metal is, set back maybe 3/4 inch for shadow line, so it looks like it was intentional, and then just the letters put on that stone like we did everywhere else on Monona Drive, and this is our entrance.
And then just Monona, or?
If we can't do the other option, well, that's up for, what one of the three, that's up for discussion, but it should look like the rest of our signs. This
mm-hmm.
looks,
I agree.
Yeah.
It underperforms compared to everything else we did on Monona Drive. That's mm-hmm. a kind way to put it.
I would take that a step further. I think it's redundant at best. And before I would spend the money to put a sign in there, I would spend the money to remove the stone. But I do like the option of moving all three of them back and put the reader board back in. But if it's a Monona sign, I think the stone should be taken out, leave the two street signs there. I don't think there should be a Monona sign there.
No. Just use landscaping?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely, landscaping between those street signs. I mean, you're how many feet are away from those nice Welcome to Monona signs that are still coming off the Beltline?
Mr. Humbert?
You are, but a lot of people come to Monona not through Monona Drive off of Broadway, and then you miss all that stuff. I might still put a sign there. It's a great discussion to have.
Mm-hmm. You know, if you're coming down Broadway, you hit it at Bridge Road.
Yeah.
Coming Broadway westbound,
you hit right.
at
the clinic.
Yeah, you're right.
From every direction, actually.
Okay.
So, Mr. Kugel.
I do like the idea, Jim. I'm glad you brought that up about potentially moving the sign back, because I, for one, always looked at that sign when I was going up the street to kind of see what was going on the following weekend or two weekends down. I actually looked at that sign a lot. It gave very good information on things that were going on in the city, events that were upcoming.
Who would know exactly how far back it would have to be, or is it just out of the right way?
I believe it's out of the right way. DOT doesn't have jurisdiction behind that.
Okay. Good. Would it be okay if I did a little independent research? I have all the drawings for that site.
Can you do the costing, too?
Costing?
Because it's going to get... It's getting to be a very expensive sign, considering it was a digital reader that we got rid of, and now we're looking at relocating it, but it's all new foundation and footings and a new digital reader retrofitted to fit.
Thanks.
Just adding, I did ask to piggyback on your comment, Rob. I asked the sign company to provide something with masonry, and they responded by saying that this is an engineered to hold that masonry. So you're saying
that's not true. That's completely untrue. That is the same foundation that's been put in everywhere else, and that's just a cop out. And that stone doesn't weigh that much.
Okay.
It's like when we want somebody to put a little skirting around a pylon sign. So, oh, the wind loads. Wind loads. You can't possibly do it.
I
disagree violently with that.
Okay.
I think it's worth looking into. And Mr. Cooper?
Is electronic signs still available to put back there?
That was my second comment. There was some decision made at council where I believe Monona State Bank donated that electronic sign.
Did they?
Yes, and
they
so it was given back to them to replace.
Well, not to them, but to the spot they furnished for the city by their landscape ground sign. That's still city controlled. Monona Bank never puts a message of their own on there. It's still a city-controlled sign in there. So if that's being put in there or was put in there, I imagine if somebody saved the old one, it could swap right back.
Right.
The thing is, when they did that one, the technology wasn't available. Mm-hmm. It was with this one, so it doesn't have the resolution. So rather than throw it away, I think Monona Bank did pay for it. They put it down in the sign location there, but it's still a city sign. So it's still city ownership.
And we should think, though, I mean... It might be an opportunity to, in technology changes. I mean, sure. The pixelation on this wasn't
brutal.
This could be an opportunity to. I think it's worth looking into. So, Mr. Hamburg, if you'd like to do that,
I will.
I could probably put graphics together to simulate.
I'm thinking a new.
I'll find out off the record.
I think we find out what.
Yeah.
If we can move it back, and then we can start to put costs to it and benefits to it.
Yeah, the first call I'll make would be to PDQ, see if they even entertain an easement for a sign. Because if they don't, then it's a moot point.
Mm-hmm. Right.
If they won't, I can report that back. But then we just make decisions on what else could happen. But if they would allow it, I have some cost data, too, on these walls. Not a big deal.
Moving utilities could get expensive, depending on what's back there. I don't know.
Correct.
But it's worth looking into.
Yeah.
But I agree, either stone or landscape or move it back and put in something different would get my vote.
And it's possible, even if we don't put the sign on it, we leave this and put some stone on the infill for now.
Yeah.
And then someday when something changes and we can put a sign back there, drop the stone out, put another sign back in there. It's because it's a remnant that's left over, correct?
Correct.
And so when does that ever twilight? Because it wouldn't be that way otherwise. We're far enough from the Beltline that it wouldn't be that way. So when does that state right away revert, if ever?
Another thing to research.
The other, is there an appeal process too? Because I find it really hypocritical that the DOT is putting up these monster signs that say 7 minutes to whatever, and
yeah,
then
really like
and then we can't
Chicago
be
or something.
Yeah, and we, you know, at whatever people are going, 55 or 60,
60,
and
70.
Then you have people at a stoplight that can't look at a sign that changes once every day.
It could be argued that their intent was within their normal right-of-way, where this is a leftover right-of-way that's beyond the area that was their intent to regulate.
So, I think a couple, could you, okay, so homework.
So, just table this. What is this discussion anyway?
Cost. Appeal.
Oh, no, this was.
DOT. Because if we also go to the DOT and say, hey, let's move it back 2 feet, and
I'm making myself a note, otherwise I'll forget to call.
That's good. Any further discussion? It is listed here as review approval, but is there
to table it, Jeff?
We could table it.
Can I do that?
Do you move to table it?
I'll move to table.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those pushing the table, say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. We table it. Thank you. Moving on to 6B, discussion of sign code updates. Direction to staff to prepare revisions.
Okay, so this has been at the Plan Commission's request for quite a while. So listed in this little memo are some just issues to prompt discussion. None of these are proposed ordinance revisions, but all points where there are issues with our sign code. The one that has come up most often, well, two, I think, the first one listed is the height restriction on landscape ground signs and whether we should continue to enforce the 5 foot height maximum. And then the second one that we've talked a lot about is the comprehensive signage plans for multi-tenant commercial buildings. But before we start going through all of these, I left a handout for you all, which is a recent U.S. Supreme Court decision, Reed versus Gilbert, where a decision was made regarding regulation of sign content. So these, this decision is something that you can take home and read, and we can use it and work through it with our city attorney as we review changes to the sign code, but it impacts things like regulations of construction signs or real estate signs or garage sale signs, any free speech sign or message that you would put in your yard, any political campaign sign. There's some distinction about on-premise versus off-premise signs, and then there's question as to whether it applies to both commercial and non-commercial. So one example of content that can be included on a commercial sign that we currently regulate is not allowing things like phone numbers and websites and email addresses and taglines. Talked a little bit with the city attorney, and his instinct at this point is that we can continue to regulate that sort of thing on a commercial sign, but wanted to give you the full decision so you can look at that a little bit more when you have time. With that being said, there are a few things in this memo that if we can't regulate content, then we won't even need to talk about a few of these things. But I want to open it up to go through each category. Or
why don't we start out, and if it's okay with everybody, just take the first height restriction on landscape ground sign. Any comments on that? Sonny, do you want to make any comments specifically on that, or just the text that you have, leave it at that? Or?
Yep, so in general, I think that, especially on Monona Drive, we have enforced the 5 foot height maximum throughout all the signs on Monona Drive, and it very specifically was a decision made together with the other design elements in order to create a more pedestrian-friendly environment, and I think that we should continue to enforce that 5 foot height maximum, at least on Monona Drive. And I listed one possible suggestion is changing the landscaping requirements. So maybe it's around the sign on the back side as opposed to in front of it at the base, so that the visibility versus the landscaping is not an issue. And then just pointing out an example in Sun Prairie, they have on one portion of their main street, it's a four-lane road that they took on some similar efforts to Monona Drive, and they have an overlay zoning district, and they tried to do some decorative pavement and consolidation of turning lanes and things, and they still have the higher ground sign allowance than Monona does. And I think the impact when you drive down Monona Drive, you just get more of that pedestrian feel and the aesthetic that the city was going for with the Monona Drive reconstruction than Sun Prairie is able to achieve with that higher sign.
What was their height?
I don't know specifics, but if you drive down that portion of their main street, you can feel the difference. Something we can research what other communities have too in more detail.
Thank you. Commission members on this topic? Mr. Humber?
Well, one alternative to allow us to still landscape them would be to limit the signage area. We could limit a total of 5 feet, but three foot of it be signage area. It leaves you 2 feet below the sign to landscape. The problem is everybody tries to fill them up with as much as they possibly can put on them. So perhaps we need to regulate maybe the lower 18 inches or whatever has to be saved, so it's the sign itself can only be 3.5 feet with a total height of 5 or something. I mean, there are other ways to do it if we're still intent on landscaping and keeping that height. I agree. I like the pedestrian friendly height. I know Griff is adamant about it, but we do have the ability, and the commission did decide to grant an exception to that tonight for a unique property. So it doesn't block it. It just makes it a standard, and I think on Monona Drive it's turned out pretty well. I do like the look of Monona Drive compared to what it was 20 years ago.
The only thing, but it doesn't, flowers don't necessarily have to go on the front of the sign, but snow also goes in front of the sign.
Mm-hmm. If you just,
I don't know that raising it is going to, would it then look out of scale?
I think you would find that the 6 feet still meets that aesthetic pedestrian feel, because I agree with Sonia about all of that. I think it's extremely important, but I think that the maximum height should be 6 feet. And to open up the possibility of not landscaping, first of all, the vast majority of the signs are going to be double-sided on Monona Drive, and everywhere on commercial signs are more than likely going to be double-sided, and so you're going to end up with kind of this gold-based landscaping theme with just things on the side of it, mm-hmm. landscaping on the side, and I think it's really important to bring that landscaping around the front. And it's just aesthetically, I think it's so restrictive. And I probably look at sign presentation a little differently than a lot of you do, but I think it continues to be a problem. I mean, the only thing you can do under all the signs of Monona is put a blue rug underneath it, and I'm sick of it.
It's a problem. Are you suggesting the sign panel be 5 foot and then a foot of?
Well, no, I think you're staying with the same square footage, all right? So I'm really taking, you know, the simplest way to explain it is that if you took every sign that's been approved at 5 feet and move it up a foot, you can enhance the landscaping underneath and considerably, and that's going to add more to a pedestrian-friendly environment than adding that foot and being more dramatic with landscaping is going to enhance pedestrian friendliness more than the current ordinance of 5 feet and limited landscaping, in my opinion.
Any other comments?
Marshall?
Well, I kind of agree with that last comment, but I guess I don't have too strong a feeling whether it would be 5 feet or 6 feet. Is it, if we don't change the amount of it that we have in the message area, then setting a 6 foot standard wouldn't give us additional flexibility to provide additional landscaping.
you that it's quite likely that there's no sign that comes any closer to the ground than a foot, is there? There's some base on every sign. We don't let them sign right to the grass or whatever it is, correct?
I think one example is like Capital Travel.
Right.
They have like blank space on their sign, but I don't think they have a real base.
Right. Because it would be hard with our current sign code for any sign to go right to the ground because you have grass, you have, as you say, snow. So if we went to 6 foot, it would be nice if we say there's a requirement, though, to have a base of a minimum of a 2 foot base that's complementary or something, because that leaves you then your landscape area and you really have 4 feet to sign by whatever width it is. And that way we take away that variable of people trying to take it right down to the ground and not having that room.
Your opinion on that?
Well, I don't. Yeah, let's say that a base was required, and I understand that desire. They look good. I like that. But I don't think you can put a minimum height on it because it really is a matter of scale. I think someone mentioned when WPS was just presenting, you know, could that base be a little lower to help with the maximum height of the sign? That aesthetically, that would have been a real problem. That sign, as you'll all find out, is going to be quite large, and the size of the base on there was definitely minimum. So it's a matter of what the sign is. The visual weight of the sign, I think, dictates the visual weight of the base. So if someone wanted kind of a small sign, and then we're telling them they have to have a 2 foot base, it might look a little funny as
well. See, I would disagree with that, because if our whole purpose of this discussion is to get landscape under the signs, if we don't define a minimum height, then everybody will crank it down as tight as they can and take advantage of the extra foot. Then we've just given away an extra foot, but we don't, if our intent is the landscape, we need to maintain a landscapable area down there that's reasonable so we can have more than the blue rug junipers.
Well, you're looking at one type of sign. And we have not many stone bases and put wood signs on them. If you look at what we do for the parks, the signs you're putting in the parks, if you look at woodland condominiums,
I agree.
Full mounted signs, and we have airspace underneath them. And it, like I said, I like stone bases. I've done tons of them with wood signs. But I think it's inappropriate for you to require somebody that wants that pole-mounted look, airspace underneath it to say they got to put a base on it.
I agree with what you said. As soon as you started speaking, I recognized my mistake. I shouldn't have said base, but the area below the sign, whatever type of sign it is, from 2 foot down, is not signable, so that there's room for landscaping. So I misspoke. When I said base, I'm thinking about what we just saw tonight, and I didn't mean to eliminate other types of signs. I think the city signs are awesome, but if we're going to allow it to get up to 6 feet, the whole point of that is so we can keep that 2 foot.
We don't want a 6 foot sign.
We don't want a sign.
Sign right there.
Right, because then what we've done is we've taken away all the landscaping. I mean, the whole purpose of raising it is to have this area now. That's why I said most signs are at least a foot off the ground. So if we take it to six and we call it's got to be 2 foot off the ground, the signable area, then we've done what we're trying to accomplish is get an area that can be reasonably landscaped, isn't blocked by snow, all this other stuff, whether it's a base or an open sign. It doesn't matter to me.
What I heard tonight was if you add more landscaping, it's going to make it more pedestrian.
More than offset that extra foot of height.
So if is there any objection to, this is kind of drafting here, and to have a landscape area or whatever you want to call it of 24 inches and then increase the height to 6 of the sign? Are we all in agreement that that's kind of how we're going? Mr. Google.
And why couldn't you have a minimum of 1 foot, a maximum of 2 foot?
Yeah, I think, I don't know if it has to be 2 foot.
If it's a smaller sign.
Exactly, like I would want to.
Mr. Andrew.
Could I add that if we have the ability to go to 6, but if you go to 6, you have to have a minimum of 2 foot.
Yep, that's exactly what I'm
saying. So otherwise, you can keep the signs like we have. If you want to take that extra foot of height, you can, but you need a minimum of 2 foot under that to be able to landscape.
You need a minimum of 1 foot on a 5 foot sign.
Yes.
Something for landscaping. Mm-hmm. So everybody's comfortable with that?
Mm-hmm.
Adding heads?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, let's move to comprehensive signage plans for buildings. Sonia? After you catch up on your
So right now we have listed those bullet points. Those are, I'm on the wrong one. The comprehensive signage plans list is included on page, on the back of the second page in the packet. So we have all of those different signage plans for these multi-tenant buildings, and they were required to have some sort of cohesive signage package for their building. But the specific standards were proposed by the developer or the property owner and then approved by the commission, and then those standards are enforced by the commission. So there are some that have been granted more exceptions than others, and some that have been held very tight to the regulations that were approved. And recently, I guess it's come up with Pier 37 in particular with the different colors. So the question is how do we move ahead? Do we continue to require the comprehensive signage plans? And if we do, do we require at a minimum size and type of signage? And if the property owner wants to propose a color requirement, then we continue to enforce what they are proposing. I think that still creates problems down the road.
Commission members' thoughts?
Well, I would, the one thing I'd correct on that is most of these properties where we have comprehensive signage plans, we as the commission asked them to put it forth. We wanted comprehensive signage plans, and we asked them to propose them, and we asked them to limit their colors.
Okay.
So it wasn't that they voluntarily said, I like all red. For years, it's been our sign code since before I was here, and it was something that we asked, and then they chose colors and size and stuff, and we said yes or no, it looks good, it doesn't look good, and then we tried diligently to enforce it through the years, and we hit a lot of people who want their own color. And back when our sign code was written, that was in vogue, to have all red or all white or whatever letters on an entire building to make it look like it was one unified building.
To have uniform, a band and maximum letter size, I think, makes sense. But does everything have to be the same color? Especially with the conflict that we've had with corporate colors.
I mentioned when Pier 37 was in here that I think the most important thing is material and type of sign. So if it's channel letters, everybody should have channel letters. If it's boxes, which are ugly, everybody should have a box, but the color, I mean, life is about branding nowadays, and you're going to make exceptions anyways, so why not open it up? I mean, you establish these rules, and then Staples comes over, and they paint their building red, and then the place next to it, what's it called?
Buffalo
Wild Wings, and they paint it fluorescent yellow, so you're just creating more headaches for yourself, really, as far as I can see. But I think that material and size, like you mentioned, is really important.
Okay.
There's going to be different colors on it, regardless of the ordinance. I'm saying, anyways.
I think the type of sign is important, too, and I would agree that the general basic box signs are really unattractive, and we've worked really hard at avoiding that type of signage on buildings. Now, I say that, and there are some really creative, different shaped ones that hit a logo, and we've approved those as an exception. They look nice.
Mm-hmm.
But to have a building with a bunch of box signs on it that you can just remove the Lexan and put a new piece in is really...
It's brutal.
Yes, it's really not attractive. And so I think regulating the type of signage is somewhat important, with room for exceptions for some of the creative things that people put on.
So the idea of a comprehensive signage plan is okay, but maybe the requirement that it have one color be revisited or eliminated.
Yeah, absolutely keep, I think, the requirement of a signage package.
Right, but the color part could be removed. We're just discussing today. We can, okay. Any further comments on that one? Moving along.
Yep.
In our comprehensive signage plan ordinance, did we ever actually specify only one color, or was that just something that we required of the practical
It's nowhere in the actual sign code itself. All it says is the plan commission may require submittal and approval of a comprehensive signage plan for a site or sites which will have more than one sign viewed together as part of a group of signs.
Which opens it up to whatever we want to require.
I mean, it gives us flexibility to address a lot of those issues that we'll be talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as long as we don't specify, it has to be on a site.
How long does a signage plan, if a developer comes along, develops a strip center, sells it, does the new owner get a chance to modify it? Mr. Harper?
Any owner can come back to the commission and ask for a change in conditions. The conditions of approval go with the property, and if it's sold, those conditions are still there. But any owner at any time can come back and say, hey, I want to revisit this condition. They have the right, if the chair deems it worthy to put it on the agenda, they have the right to ask for a change in the condition, whether it's signage or anything else.
Okay.
I would like to say, though, this has been, this color thing is a big deal, because we've talked about it a lot. And if we decide that we're going to throw it out, then the reason I think we should talk about it like this is so we make sure, what's the consensus of the commission? You know, if everyone in the commission says, yeah, you know, to have a little personal character in each storefront might be nice, to know that it really is a Starbucks with the green and white, that would be kind of nice as familiar. I mean, but we just have to make sure we all agree, because once we do it, we can't go back.
Yeah. I think the exercise today will be kind of get the consensus of what we want, and then we can put it back, because we've got some members missing too. Have them have a chance to vote on it too. Yes, Mr. Google.
I can just say that I work on the far west side, and there are probably 8 or 10 new mini strip malls have been put out there, nice ones on Old Sauk Road. Mm-hmm. In that area, I don't see any consistent color of the signs out there at all. Mm-hmm. They're just, everyone's kind of a distinct to what they're selling. Wild Birds Unlimited,
yeah.
Subway. I mean, if everything was just the same across the front of there, I don't think that looks very good either. But Wild Birds Unlimited, they have a whole different signage on the script of their sign than the one next to it that is the Qdoba's or whatever is in that place next to it. So,
Bill, did you?
Rufus Clarence, throw up, I do have a little comment.
Okay, go ahead.
This is kind of a side note of this, but as signs are being discussed, and quite honestly, I don't know what the solution is. It's always a headache, you know, both as a sign director and as a municipality, but I don't know. The multi-tenant sign is a tremendous challenge in both size and aesthetically. And I think the Waypoint sign is a very good example of that. And I was concerned about the proportions of that and the tenant plaques that were coming out. And that 6 feet might help that.
Mm-hmm.
But if more of those start to evolve, they're going to be a huge problem.
Well, good transition to the next bullet point is multi-tenant identification on ground surface.
Could I, before we get off this one? Personally, I would love to see something, if we redo it a little bit, that says we are going to highly discourage standard box signs for signage. Mm-hmm. If we feel that that's, if we get a consensus that those aren't really...
On buildings.
Yes, on buildings.
Okay. Anything else? I didn't mean to rush, but if not, Sonia, why don't you get us into the multi-tenant?
Right now, the code says that wall signage shall generally identify each use, while off-building signage shall identify the building only. And this has clearly not been enforced. And below are examples of ground signs that have multiple tenants or multiple listings or services provided on it. And I have a little map that was created on our online GIS with, right now I think it has 20 photos of ground signs that I can bring to the next meeting, and it can flip through by location and show each ground sign so that we can see what that looks like and maybe make a more informed decision about what we like and don't like. But just something that if we're going to allow multi-tenant signs, then we would need to revise that language or consider a different sort of policy.
As long as I've been struggling with signs, I never knew about this. And one thing I would say is I see our own buildings on there, and I didn't know about it then, but I would much rather see the sign I have out front with listing the tenants than four signs on my building. I would hate four signs on my building. I don't like it at all. And there are actually no signs on our building. So all it does is recognize the people are in there rather than putting on the building. To me, that's better than having four signs hanging on that building.
Mm-hmm.
So, and like I say, I didn't really even know that we didn't allow it.
So if a multi-tenant sign is at the street, then there would be no building signs.
Well, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying in my particular case, I would much prefer that, and it's something we could look at maybe.
But is that something we could look at? If you have building signs, if you have signs on the buildings, then the front sign identifies we'll call it a campus?
Right. An example would be Crawford's Landing, which I know is on here. They have signs for every single business, but then they've also got signs out on landscape ground sign. So there's some redundancy there. Well, it's totally redundant.
Yeah, that's a good thought.
You do one or the other.
Yeah, and as I look at this list, it gets more complicated. I mean, this list, and of course I'm not remembering all of them, but these are even the Hamburg sign, there's a building identification and then a modest list of names on it.
Correct.
And that's very different than the Trace to sign. Where Trace to wants their own thing. The restaurant wants their own thing, and each one of those tenants is going to want their own thing, and that is really going to turn into a goat rodeo. But to identify a building and then consistently identify
the
seven tenants that are, mm-hmm. really is not a problem. And I think even what Crawford's Landing is, they're not all doing their own thing in that box.
No.
So that's really where the problem
is. So if you are going to have multiple signs, to have some consistency there and not...
Yeah, if there's going to be a tenant ground sign, it's got a building identification header and then the consistent list of names underneath.
Consistent colors and consistent type.
Yeah, it's just a list of names.
Yeah, I agree.
I would agree with that. Were you saying we wouldn't have necessarily restrictions on building sign? I mean, if it's a strip business or something, then, I mean... As a business,
no, I'll tell you, retailers, you know, like Crawford's Landing, I mean, they're going to fight for both. I mean, that can cancel a project if you don't allow both.
Yeah.
Can cancel that type of project.
But what could happen, though, in Crawford's Landing is they could just skip the site sign and just go with the signage on the building.
Well, they totally should. I think they should. I think that's great. But I'm saying as a municipality, to require one or the other could literally kill those types of retail projects.
So would it be, if they do want a site sign with multiple tenant and they want the names on the building, then the sign would have to be one color, one, you know.
Just a very understated list of tenants.
Uniform. You're not going to have green Starbucks and,
logo
and U.S.
Here,
Air Force
and
in blue
logo,
and,
right.
and Staples in red. They're all going to be one color.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Because they get to do their thing on the building.
They get to do their thing on the building. Or if they fight about it, they just skip the site sign.
I'm only laughing because in Cottage Grove I have a horrid, horrid, ugly sign up by the road because people put all their own colors on it. It was allowed. It is nasty.
Yeah.
I use the word brutal for that one too, Chris.
Yeah, it really was. Yeah, you've seen it. Yeah. It really is bad when you start doing that. It's terrible.
Two other examples to think about. The new Qdoba, Mr. Bruce Tapp House, they have signs on the building and on the ground sign, but in that case, I don't know what you would put for building identification. If you just want to choose a random name for the building and have that, because it's really two retail tenants instead of one center. And then another example is the Tempted Salon and Professional Center Office Building. They each have a wall sign and a shared ground sign together. So it's two tenants, but not a building identification name on the ground sign.
Oh, I see.
Two separate buildings on one sign.
More times than that, when there's not a name, there's kind of an emphasis put on the address, okay, or whatever it's worth.
That's two separate buildings? No, it's not two separate buildings.
Tempted and the other, or are they both the same?
The Qdoba and...
No, Qdoba is the same building.
Mm-hmm. And in that one, you could emphasize the address, and then on the other one, you could put two addresses, I guess. It's two separate buildings, but...
Okay. To that, I would answer, there's always going to be something where we have to make an exception. Mm-hmm. But we're trying to eliminate as many of those as we can.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, when you've only got two, you know, like a Trista and Waypoint.
Is that Waypoint?
Mm-hmm. When there's only two of them, but when you get six of them, if two of them are a little bit different, does that still bother you as much as when you get six of them?
I guess there were... you mean in terms of them doing their own thing? Not so much if they're equally balanced, but like Trace and Waypoint are not. Like if you were to take, they got little tiny little strips underneath for additional tenants on there. But if it was just Waypoint and Trace, I think if they're weighted the same, then that can look nice. But it's this, science people, they come to, we have more square footage than they do, so we want that to be reflected in the sign.
Yeah. Okay. So, Mr. M?
So if two are okay, then can I come in with three, and would that be okay? Because it's only one more. And let's go back to, what's the purpose of a landscape ground sign? What is its purpose? It's not to advertise every tenant. It's to identify the property.
Mm-hmm.
Really? Isn't that what it's for? We're letting put them right out within 15 feet of the curb so you can identify your property so when people are coming, they can find that property. So you could name your building. You could, if you want to put multiple tenants in there, keep it consistent. You could just put address on like you suggested. But the whole purpose is not to do all that. The purpose that we think we have for landscape ground sign is to identify the property.
Okay.
I don't know. It's just another thought.
Kind of thing.
Go ahead. One more thing just to consider in general is that we want to have the language be such so that you're not telling people, oh, well, we'll know it when we see it, come and propose something to us. So it has to have some level of mm-hmm. predictability
mm-hmm.
and some sort of quantitative standard.
Consistency and fairness.
Well, I don't know. I'll let you know if I like
it. So, let's move to the next content regulation on commercial signage. So,
this one's come up before, and a few examples are SWOD was proposed with the tagline, "The best taste in town." Plan Commission did not allow it and did permit it to have Indian cuisine.
Mm-hmm.
Staff, I recently denied a wall sign permit that contained a phone number and a web address and just allowed them to have the business identification. And then there are some examples below that four that we've allowed. So just looking at that and wondering if there's anything that could be clarified to make it easier to regulate and administer. Because the one thing that I point to right now is the language under the wall sign definition, which says that it's a business identification sign, and that's all it says.
Right, and we've allowed in the past, if it's a business that one might not be real familiar with what they provide, we have allowed like Indian cuisine or things like that, but we don't want people stopping on the road trying to read a website or copy it down or a phone number. I think that goes back to just safety.
Mm-hmm.
It's just not appropriate advertising on that.
Will that help you? Do you see a problem with, do you run into problems with the way it's worded now?
I think if it were a little bit stronger, it would be easier, or maybe, so right now it says all it says is a sign that identifies the building or business. So I guess looking at it, that doesn't include contact information or advertising or taglines, but I could probably propose something clarifies that a little bit.
Yeah. Sounds good. Why don't you propose something?
Okay.
We'll let you know if we like. No, I think these examples you have here, Sonia, though, I think the phone number and the website, it starts to turn into a yellow page ad real quickly. But when you look at these examples of exceptions that you've made, Devonish, interior planning, interior architecture, facility design, handlement. You know, I don't have a problem with those. I mean, they're not really taglines in that sense, you know, but I don't, the best taste in town. I don't think that's so bad, but I think the phone number on the website.
And I think that's the thing that needs to be clarified is it an advertising message or is it business identification?
Or business clarification.
Mm-hmm.
Business clarification.
Okay.
So I guess I'm saying definitely business clarification. And then the tagline thing is kind of a separate item.
Okay. Let's move to wayfinding signs.
Okay, so this came up when we were reviewing the Dane County Historical Marker for Ernie's Trading Post. We weren't really sure what sign standards and regulations to apply to it as far as height and size. For a couple of reasons. One, because wayfinding's not defined in the sign code, and also because based on that signage district's map that's included, we don't really know what district it's in or if government and the municipality or...
Is that really, like Ernie's, is that really a wayfinding sign or is it more of a, I mean, it's a historic marker, right?
That's what we're talking about.
Right, but
right.
I mean...
I guess, yeah, there's a distinction between those two.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wayfinding would be identified as off-premise directional signs.
Right.
Right. Okay. So beyond those things, I think this is one of those signs that's going to fall into the Supreme Court case, because if when you read it, you'll see one of the things that...
Oh. I was going to say, why don't we do our homework and read it and then have further discussion on this. Because if we're going to have a discussion and we don't know what's in there. Okay.
If this is mostly historical markers, at least in this town, aren't most of the historical markers somewhat similar, metal with something written on them?
Who knows?
We have boulders with plaques, and we have the state historical marker at Royal Airport, and we have Dane County historical marker.
Oh, we have two different kinds.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, let's do our homework and come back to this one. Real estate signs, perpetual.
The issue that I point out is that the code allows for a real estate sign to be up and allowed on the property and then removed 7 days after the sale or lease is accomplished. And in one example, in the 6320 professional office space building, it's never fully leased, so the sign's been up for years.
It's huge.
So when that applicant came to Plan Commission on their ground sign, they had office space for lease with a phone number, so we removed that, having it because it was a contact information.
So, what's the thought there?
That's a tough one.
That's a tough one, is right, because what do you...
Someone's got space for lease.
Yeah, but do you make them move it periodically and relocate it?
Wait, I mean, is this the one, that's the one next to the McDonald's?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's a huge sign, isn't it?
This is across from Taco John's.
Oh, well, there's one next to McDonald's that has a lease sign on it, as long as I've lived in Madison, I mean, in Monona, I think. And it's a huge wooden something hanging on the side of the building all the time.
Yep.
All the time.
But like Sonia said, it's never leased up fully. And if it is, we wouldn't know, right, to say, yeah, I've got a space open.
Well, I work out in a business park on the west side. They don't allow these big lease signs hanging on the buildings out there, and I know that there's space in our building. So I don't know how it's advertised, but they don't have signs hanging all over the buildings, permanent signs.
Comment I had down here is, what do other communities do on this issue? Can we get some ideas from them? Okay. Because I'm also sympathetic to the business owner who wants to fill the space, and I don't necessarily make it harder for them either.
Huge sign.
Site district map. Sign district map. Sorry.
In short, it's outdated and really difficult to use, and not all of the commercial districts are even included within the boundaries that are shown on the sign district map. For example, the bowling alley area is outside of the commercial district lines that border Monona Drive. The commercial businesses of, in the neighborhood's small business zoning district, Monona Motors and the ice cream shop, don't fall into a commercial category. And I think right now it's shown on this map that they would fall into the second table.
Is this something that in your spare time you could shot at a feet and bring back to us?
Yep.
Thank you. All right, standard table for multifamily residential park, governmental, public, and quasi-public use districts.
This is another one that I can clean up, but maybe if there is a certain reason that the Plan Commission knows of about why there are multiple categories. So going to the sign table, the second one is the multifamily residential parks, and then construction you'll see is listed twice. And then the standards, one is allowed per site, but then in the first one, 36 square feet per sign, and in the second one, 20 square feet per sign. So I don't know if there was a method to that or if it was just random.
Sorry, where are you?
Page 408 and the 409, right?
In the sign code printed out on the table under multifamily, so page 408 and 409 at the bottom. And construction's highlighted, but real estate is another one, and political or campaign is another one.
I think you take a shot at trying to make
get rid of one
sense here. I can't think of any reason that they'd be. They were probably just modified individually and wasn't looked at as a whole. So, Chris?
That would be my guess. I'm just going to pass on a little lore. Maybe Griff could relate to this because it happened before I got here, but I have it on good authority, actually Kathy Thomas, that we bought our book, our ordinance book, out of the trunk of a guy's come by and said, I have a community just like yours, I just wrote this thing up and I will give you a great deal on this. And we pretty much bought it out of his trunk because it was another lakefront community that had just done it about our size. Mm-hmm. And we have been struggling with this book of codes and ordinances ever since, updating, finding things that were off. So all I'm saying is it might have been in there originally, it might not. Might have been added.
We sell meat too.
I again, this is lore, so I don't have all the details. But that's what I understand.
I think Sony just take a shot at trying to fix it. Other design considerations. What are your?
Excuse me.
Yes, sir.
Do you want to simplify that? So go for the first one and make 32 square feet, and then the other one altogether.
I can do that. I think it's going to take looking at the entire, all of the tables together and possibly rewriting the entire thing.
Yeah.
So. You're
looking for another salesman.
Other design considerations, Sonia?
So behind this, again, was do we just have the applicants come and we tell them if that the legibility and visual clarity of the sign is acceptable, or do we give them more prescriptive standards? And the example that I'm using is specifically regarding text size, and we've always thrown around the commonly accepted text size that's readable is 3 inches, and that's per accepted signage standards. Just like in our code, we have some language that says per generally accepted engineering standards. And do we continue to leave that door open and use our 6 vague evaluation factors, or is that something when we start looking at this that we want to be more specific about?
Well, wouldn't it change depending upon how fast traffic's going
and how far it is from the road?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You can't start talking about letter signs.
Okay.
I can't. I mean, it's just impossible to design.
Are there standards that, you know, that you're on? Depending upon how fast traffic is.
There's distance visibility based on speed limits and things like that.
And I bet there are.
But then there's, so those definitely exist.
Should we just cross-reference those?
And make it a requirement, are you saying? Based on...
You just can't go there. I mean, a client comes to you and their icon includes a script font. I mean, that just needs to be significantly larger to get any visibility out of it than someone who comes with the cherished Helvetica, mm-hmm. you know, where it's big and bold. mm-hmm. So, I just don't see how you could begin to start dictating those things up front. It just sounds impossible to me.
Okay. Question. I don't know much about this, so if there is a chart that says what's readable at a certain distance and speed, would it be reasonable to have that as a minimum?
Or as a guideline or something?
Yeah, a guideline with, you know, we can change
stuff. Sure, but it will be, you know, those are all, well, I guess there might be some that are created by manufacturers, but a lot of those are DOT, and they are all based on Helvetica. And, you know, which, for example, is a font that I've never used. And so, you know, it's, you know, the only, in other words, you have to determine the font before you can determine that formula, right? So the formulas that exist out there are based on...
the most readable font.
Based on...
So if that was our minimum, it might at least give some... She's looking for something she can have and say, hey, here's the whatever association for whomever, and this is their minimum standards. We like to at least hit that, and we can make exceptions, but this is a starting point.
Have you had a sign come through here ever with less than 3-inch letters?
We've required people to increase the letter size.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Well, Trista is going to have
that was
less
the most
than
recent
3-inch.
One. Just an example that Chris probably understands a million times better than me, but I think in the stormwater codes for stormwater facility design, they have Dane County best management practices and guidelines that you can meet to achieve the stormwater performance. So it would be that exact same thing, but is there a document that you can reference universally for signage?
Not from a government side of it, thank God. You know, there's a big difference between stormwater and signs. So all the
concept of
there's unlimited sign regulations, you know, government sign regulations, but they all have to do with highway signs.
Yeah, okay.
ADA and, you know, that kind of thing. But as far as, you know, there's no standards for multifamily. Should be like this, and this. I suppose the government would like to do that.
In this case, you are the government.
Well,
something
I don't think it should be done. you're concerned that everything is, you know, is effectively visible, and some of that needs to go on, you know, contractors and designers.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Well, and my concern from administering the code is subjectivity.
Yes.
This is what?
She wants to eliminate subjectivity.
Yeah.
And it's not going to be perfectly prescriptive.
You're talking about aesthetics, it can't be done.
Okay.
So in that
is what I'm thinking.
But, wall sign review.
This one is a process question. Right now, the code says that all signs that accompany changes in use or new use which receives approval of a zoning permit, those signs need to come back for approval by the Plan Commission. So, for example, Jing's Asian Kitchen had a zoning permit review, and therefore their wall sign came back for Plan Commission approval. I don't know if that was the original intent of that portion of the code, or if it was really intended to be when a building is newly constructed and there might be comprehensive signage standards that we want to look at. In that case, then it would come back. But in all other wall sign cases, they can be approved by staff. So my question is do we reword that? Or
in which direction?
In order to allow staff to approve a wall sign unless it is under new construction would be one example.
Less signs.
I know.
So, Mr. Umber.
I think everyone here knows how much I like looking at signs.
You sure do talk a lot about them.
And for those that don't know, I really don't like looking at signs. But we did do that on purpose. We felt that if there was enough change that it required a zoning permit, then we should look at the sign. And I've got to say, over the last, say, 10 years, I think over half of those that have come back, we've had comments on. I love the signs that come back, like the one you mentioned, says, yeah, great sign, works perfect, good night. And I don't want to make those people have to come to a meeting, but if I look back on it, there's been a lot of signs brought. When it was required to have a zoning permit, it's usually because of a change of use or a substantial change, and that's why we triggered it that way. And I believe, and you know, you all could comment on it, but I believe over half of those we've had comments on, and we've asked for some things to be changed or certain things. And I really don't want to see more signs, but I believe there's been a purpose to it. Whereas staff, if there's no zoning permit and it meets the requirements, you know, you just approve it. And what we've done in the past, too, on that one, the reason we left that so open is we've always said, you know, if you're not sure, if you have a question, send it to Plan Commission.
Mm-hmm.
But if it meets everything and it's a no-brainer, take care of it.
Other comments?
Okay.
I can't argue with it.
I agree.
Thank you, Sonia.
Mm-hmm.
Discussion on lighting at park shelters. We had this is a great picture. I love it. It kind of looks like headlights in a car. And
did we have photometrics? Are we holding the city to the same standard that we hold? Mr.
I'm not sure photometrics would tell the story on this, but I know with all private that come in, we almost always talk about shielded lighting.
Yeah.
And so how did we do this ourselves without shielded lighting would be my question, because we always ask for that. And I guess we'd have to go back in the tapes. I thought we talked about having them shielded. This clearly isn't shielded.
I mean, I don't know if there's anything Plan can do on this right now. I don't know if we have any teeth or whatever, but it's a lesson learned, I think, is how did we screw up, or did they not provide what they told us they were going to provide? Mr. Stein, you wanted to say something?
Well, your photometrics would tell us if it met minimum and maximum lumens. And then either it did or it didn't, and
yeah.
I don't know what recourse that provides us, but it would tell us if that's required by the city. I'm not even sure. The city of Madison,
we have
very strict, or not, yeah, very spelled out photometric requirements.
Yeah, Mr. Amber.
Photometrics could tell us if there's too much light escaping the site or not enough light in one area, but photometrics won't tell us glare. So what I meant by photometrics won't tell us, you could hit your photometrics with this, but still have glare. And glare is the thing we're always concerned about. And I think if this were a private business, we wouldn't have any teeth left. But since it is Monona, I think we certainly can make a recommendation to somebody, whether it's the parks, council, whomever. We just don't let this go up, especially in a residential area with that kind of glare normally.
What is the language that we have if a business has something that creates glare or issue? What is the language that is there?
It says with elimination of all street parking permits, establishment of directives of not to gas directly upon public right of ways occupied in structures of neighboring property.
Right.
So establishment directed so as not to be cast.
Right.
Unless that just starts off street parking, but I mean that's the principle.
And these new LED lights have a lot more glare than the old Mr.
I was just looking in the write-up from Sonia. It said that the light fixture used is this 3CR grill.
Mm-hmm.
I look at the grill details. It's a grill that the light is going to come out straight out of it.
Right.
It's not a shield like the NB would be a shield, wouldn't it? Chris?
Which one?
The MDs, the picture they show, it doesn't have the cuts in it?
I can't tell. It looks like it's got nothing. None of these look like they're shielded fixtures.
Well, I think the 3CR means that there's maybe three openings in it that...
No, I think those are the bands. If you look, well, maybe. I think the light comes everywhere but those three narrow bands.
Oh.
And I think on NB, there's nothing. It just casts straight out.
And what I'm not comfortable with are the suggestions of moving from 14 watt to 7 watt and reducing the lumens to 600.
I think it needs, I think it needs some, it seems to need a shield on them.
I mean, do we have the right to say that this is in violation of what we authorized and that they're going to have to come back with something to...
Have to run out there and take a look and see if those three openings are for the light to come through or if those are the heart metal parts.
I'm sorry, Robert.
We'd have to go back and look at our review to say whether or not it's in violation of what we authorized, but I think it's clearly in violation of what our light code shows, which is the glare hitting the residential. And
regardless,
it's in violation of that. And our standards have always been to cut down on glare. We might have missed it when we reviewed that. We might have talked about it. It was a yeah thing, so we didn't put a condition in. And then this fixture was pipped. So there could be a lot of people that are culpable, but I think it's inappropriate to have that shining on a residential unit.
Absolutely. And it's the same one as Fireman's, but the distance is greater at Fireman's before.
It doesn't make Fireman's right, though. But, we haven't had complaints. Maybe it's a more tolerant neighbor, too.
Right. But this is not...
And I just think in the city's best interest, that was a controversial installation as it was to put that larger shelter in there, and then to put this on and let the neighbors live with that, I think is inappropriate. No matter what, since it's a city, we can fix it.
What, if anything, can we do? We make a recommendation? Do we have any teeth that we can?
I think we definitely have the teeth in the code to make a change. I don't know exactly what the solution is, whether that's, it sounds like it should be some sort of shielded lighting. I asked the architect and the parks director to come tonight, but they're not here. So I don't know what is possible or what their suggested solution might be. But I can schedule it on the next agenda.
So if they're in violation, what do we do? I mean, what teeth are there?
Doesn't meet our code, but I think our teeth
take
are we
your zoning permit?
No, I think we have two council members on the plan commission. I think they take it to the council. And we could take a recommendation from plan commission to the council if this is in violation of our light standards.
I like that.
Yeah, just fix it.
Yeah.
If it comes to that, do we need teeth? Can we not just talk to Jake and say, hey, this isn't right? And then if there was a problem, then I guess the council holds the purse string, so I think.
And they're proposed for Schluter Park, too, so now is the time to address this.
Because there's residences right across.
Right across.
The discussion is, if you could talk to Jake and find out, but do we want to see what he's coming back with? Is it change, Mr.
If I can make a suggestion, we're just discussing this tonight, so it'd be nice if Sonia could have a discussion with Jake. Talk about the consensus, but then post it for an action item next time so we could take an action to make a recommendation to council or parks or somebody of what should happen if that discussion isn't fruitful.
And, yeah.
But we can't really take an action on it and make a recommendation.
Enough information.
Right. So, and based on the discussion, I would not go to Jake with the recommendation that he spent money to switch.
Oh, absolutely, you can. You could relay the discussion tonight that it should be a shielded fixture and take a look at them, but I mean, they say, no, we're not going to do it. Well, we don't have any sway over that once we've granted it.
Do we want to see it before he goes and does it, though?
Well, what I was going to say is his suggestion was to reduce from 14 watt to 7 watt, and so my recommendation based on this conversation is don't spend the money on that as your solution.
Right.
Yeah, and do we want to see some photometrics? How is he going to eliminate this glare? Going from, I also heard there was discussion rather than four, go down to two. Well, that doesn't solve the problem.
No.
These are headlights staring in somebody's.
It won't be quite as bright, but it's still going to be a headlight.
Right. So, yeah, I guess a conversation with Jake that the Planning Commission feels this is in violation of city ordinance. He's got a, and we'd like to see his recommendation. Is that, I would.
Yeah. Which I'm just shocked because we require everyone that comes here to have a shielded fixture. I don't know how we didn't here.
Is that in a file that would easily...
I tried to find it, and I didn't find any record of the plan commission specifically discussing the wall fixture.
Did he present them?
I haven't been able to find it, but I was going to do some more digging.
Because he might have never presented the fixture, yeah. So it'd be hard to comment on if we don't see them.
Mm-hmm.
But big picture for us, we get photometrics from other folks to see how much light's going to be spilling over. We got to get something like this for ourselves.
Yes, but photometrics don't tell the whole story. There's still glare.
Yep. Okay. Thank you for bringing that up. Okay, moving on to seven. Report. Yes, sir.
Can I reluctantly take a step back into science for just a moment?
Absolutely.
This is a light conversation. Maybe you think of this. I don't believe there's anything in the ordinances regarding menu boards.
Correct.
There's not, you know, at McDonald's, they're behind the building. At the taco place, they're behind the building. It was, I bumped out today when I saw the backs of these aluminum boxes on Broadway for Qdoba. Because you come around, because of how you're coming into the drive-thrus, and I don't remember any conversation about those whatsoever, and all of a sudden there's these big aluminum, unfinished aluminum boxes.
Big arcs.
On poles. The backs of them are facing Broadway. They're like 5 feet off the street.
Yeah.
I'm like, boy, that's pleasant. So here we're talking about science, aesthetics, and colors, and here we've got right on Broadway the back.
It's like a portable permanent sign.
They're horrible. They're not. What do you mean?
Like they can move them, but they're there all the time.
No, it's an architectural.
Menus, yeah, they're there all the time.
It's got a
menu board for you.
You drive into McDonald's, go through the
drive-through.
Did we have any show the size and cover?
I don't remember.
They weren't on
any
the site plan.
They weren't on the site plan. Then we can ask them to come back and get them landscaped or do something. To,
right.
They're in landscape.
But the applicant, what I recall the applicant describing was that it was similar to Noodles & Company where there is no menu board. I don't know if that was stated specifically, but you call ahead and you go to the window and you pick up your order.
Well, isn't that what I'm seeing? I'm just assuming those are the menu boards. They're right at the drive-thru.
I haven't seen them, but what you're describing is you look at the menu and you make your order while you're in the drive-thru.
And yeah, there's a sign out there that's, you know, like this, and it's on a pole, and it's a metal box, and I just assumed the other side was the menu, and the side facing Broadway is the back of it.
But if it wasn't on the site plan, then they don't have permission to put it up. The other thing I don't think they have permission to put up was that canopy.
Right.
That was the other thing I was.
That was my question. Did we approve additional signs there? When I saw, I wasn't there at that meeting. Did we really approve that many wall signs?
No.
There's a huge Qdoba on the canopy.
I've asked
that many
them to
wall remember. Signs were approved.
The canopy?
No, not the canopy.
Yeah, so you have two signs on that same facade.
Yeah, right. One right underneath.
Right. That doesn't meet sign code. That was my question for last question.
Right. So I've asked them to remove that before occupancy permit, and the traced sign is being removed or moved before an occupancy permit as well.
Oh, well done.
Yay, Sonia.
Sonia's tough. She dresses all in black and brings her violin case and goes out to the site.
Well done on that.
The canopy with your sign?
That's huge. The sign's going to be that tall on the canopy. It said Qdoba with a signboard for Qdoba right above it.
Yeah.
They told me they didn't consider it signage.
I don't like the color either.
You told them we do?
Staff and commission members, staff reporting steps of development project, Sonia.
So I don't have any new development proposals, just those updates on the trace design and the Qdoba awning, and the next meeting is November 9th.
Okay. Request for information, I think we may have already covered that. So we move it. No rushing, but okay. Moving on to 8, adjournment. Is there a motion?
Second.
All those in favor.
Aye.
Yay. Thank you, everybody.